Good morning. My name is Tom Finney. I'm at the Felderstein Law Firm in Sacramento, California. It is my great pleasure to introduce our moderator for our panel this morning, How the Colorado River Runs or Runs Out, A Look Beneath the Surface. The speakers are taking questions towards the end of the panel, so there are cards on your tables. Please fill out a question as you go, and we'll circulate and bring them up and give them to the moderator so that she can pose them to our distinguished speakers. Our moderator for the panel is Felicia Marcus. She is the William C. Landreth Visiting Fellow at the Stanford University's Water in the West program. She was recently chair of the California State Water Resources Control Board. Prior to that appointment, Ms. Marcus served in positions in government, the nonprofit world, and the private sector, including she was the regional administrator of the United States EPA Region 9. She was the president of the Board of Public Works for the City of Los Angeles, and among other gigs, she was the law clerk to Ninth Circuit Judge Harry Pregerson. Please join me in welcoming Felicia Marcus.
Seconds off our transitions, because there's a lot of information to share with you today. We're delighted, I know I can speak for the whole panel, that we're delighted to be here with you today, and I'm particularly honored and humbled to be moderating with such a distinguished and experienced group of water professionals, each of them with decades of experience in water, particularly on the Colorado River. Our goal today is to give you just a taste of the complexity of the issues surrounding the Colorado River that goes beyond what you can get in the headlines and what you listen to in the media. Our hope is to arm you for what you continue to read and consume in the media, with the risk of maybe leaving with more questions than answers at the end. You'll be the judge when we get there. We're going to give you a sense of the hydrology, a sense of the legal issues at play, and some of the politics, but again, know it's just a taste, and hopefully we'll leave you with a taste for more, and at least a touch more prepared if any of these issues do happen to come your way. But most of all, and I like to do this when I do California Water 101, we're going to arm you for that cocktail party conversation where that jerk comes up and says, "If those bleeping idiots would just do that one thing, we wouldn't have these problems." And you all know that guy or woman. And this will just arm you to ask delicate and probing questions or to counter them if you like to. So specifically at the outset, I want to thank you all for having us here. It's always nice when people want to know beyond the headlines. And specifically want to thank Judge Hurwitz, Tom Finney, Roger Townsend, and Brian Goldman, who really helped us get here today. And I'm giving you a bunch of slides, but I'm not going to spend time on them because they'll be in your materials afterwards in PDF, so consider it notes. So again, we're going to talk hydrology, law, and politics a little bit, and we're going to give you some views from the field, but not precisely this. The experts here have a lot of more expertise on some things and all, but they're all here to talk about the issue as a whole. And as I say in here, the goal of this panel is to illuminate, not litigate, not to be a law review article, but to get you started, to give you a sense of things. So for example, I'm a Californian, but we don't have an official Californian on the panel. California obviously has a lot of legal arguments and a lot of issues and a lot of equities, and maybe we'll get to that in the discussion, and I'm gonna invite my colleagues to channel their California friends and some of the other states as well. So we'll see how we do. If I have to pull moderators for privilege, I will, but I don't think I will. So I'm gonna start talking about our speakers. You'll see their pictures in a moment just to get through it. Look again on the web, they have a wealth of experience. I'll just tell you briefly, Bob Anderson is the solicitor for the Department of the Interior, the top lawyer appointed by President Biden. He previously served as associate solicitor and counsel to Secretary Bruce Babbitt during the Clinton administration. He's worked on high-stakes, complex water issues across the nation. He's also been a professor of law at both the University of Washington and Harvard Law School, and started his career at the Native American Rights Fund. And Castle is a senior fellow at the Getchess Wilkinson Center for Natural Resources, Energy, and Environment at the University of Colorado Boulder School of Law. She is also the U.S. Commissioner, appointed by President Biden, on the Upper Colorado River Basin Commission. Previously answered in the Obama administration as the Assistant Secretary of the Interior for Water and Science, where she oversaw the Bureau of Reclamation and the U.S. Geological Service. She's also heavily involved in the Water and Tribes Initiative that you'll hear about. Professor Sharon Megdahl is the Director of the Water Resources Research Center at the University of Arizona. She previously was a commissioner on the Arizona Corporation Commission, which includes the work that many of you are familiar with, the State Public Utilities Commission. She was appointed by then Governor Bruce Babbitt and later served for many years as an elected board member of the Central Arizona Project. She has a PhD in economics from Princeton, and in May 2023, she was appointed to Governor Hobbs' Water Policy Council, also involved in the Water Tribes Initiative. John Hensmeyer, last but definitely not least, is the General Manager of the Southern Nevada Water Authority in the Las Vegas Valley Water District, where he's served in various roles for over 20 years, including General Counsel. He is a leading voice involved directly in the negotiations over the Colorado River on behalf of the state of Nevada, having been appointed as Nevada's lead negotiator by Governor Brian Sandoval. The Southern Nevada Water Authority has the most ambitious recycling and water use efficiency programs in the nation, some of which you'll hear about. There we go. I won't go through it again. It's for your notes. Hydrologically, the bottom line is we've been in a mega drought in the West. The reservoirs were recently near what's known as Deadpool. I love doing it that way because it reminds me of Deadpool, but it's really, I think, probably not capitalized. The power generation, affected 40 million U.S. people were at risk, or parts of the 40 million. We had a modest recovery with a snowpack of Palooza that happened last year, but it just buys us a little more time. And there's always been a big hydrological imbalance between the agreement assumptions and what really exists. So we have an issue with climate change as the game changer for all of it. Next slide. Again, going back to the famous John Wesley Powell in the late 1800s, always said many droughts will occur, said don't count on this for rapid expansion or irrigation, and the irrigation has won the argument, and the projects and the programs and the economy that's actually a modern miracle and historical development ensued, but the risk has always been known. Just to give you another picture, we are very variable drought hydrology. Everyone in the West realizes we don't have the same kind of regular precipitation that the East does. Our water systems and water rights systems are different as a result, and we have variable hydrology from year to year, season to season, etc. This is the nightmare that we're all looking at. This is just California pictures. Wildfires come from climate change as well that have huge impacts on the water system. The same is true in the Rocky Mountains. And this is all the freight train of pain that all of us in the Southwest are looking at coming at us collectively while we argue. I won't say at the margins, but while we argue about our piece of the pie. But people who are involved in it realize the scope of this issue. It's just how to deal with it, what to do about it, and not to be a chump giving too much away. It really makes it rather difficult. But it's a big deal. We've got 40 million people, 30 tribes, 2 countries, 7 states involved, vast swath of the world, a lot of tribes that have a significant interest, unquantified rights, but the total potential is really a huge chunk of this water. The fact that it hasn't been realized is a whole set of issues that we'll talk a little bit about, but a very important part of it and thankfully part of the discussion. Again, I won't go through this, just put some things on deck that are some of the law and agreement, very abridged. If you will see on the PDF, there's a citation of the Colorado River Water Users Association website that gives you a very detailed timeline all along of how we got here. The only point I would make here, and it'll be talked about, all my colleagues will talk about these things more, is that there have been interim agreements that have forestalled this day over the course of the last decade, and my hat's off to all of the negotiators that came together to be able to do that. I think their biggest test is ahead. We dodged a bullet in this last year with the snow that we got, with $4 billion out of the Inflation Reduction Act and some temporary agreements among the lower basin states to hold back, to buy us the time to be able to really talk about 2026
which is when a lot of these agreements expire. And I won't say all bets are off, but a lot of bets are off. I won't go again through a lot of the legal issues, but they fall into a number of buckets. There are issues of water rights, and you will hear claims, for example, that California is senior to Arizona. It's more complicated than that. Within each state, you have seniors and juniors. There are folks in Arizona that are way senior to folks. Most of the folks in California, you have urban and ag, with agriculture tending to have more senior rights. But again, as the universal answer in water is not 42, it depends. So it's all very site-specific, and that guy at the cocktail party is always making one sweep and one generalization. But there's probably nothing that's as complex as water, where it really depends on where you are, what your rights are. Do you have groundwater, you have surface water, et cetera. So just to let you know. And there's a lot of litigation risk that everybody has, which is what, in part, has driven these agreements. Where we are now, again, list for you later. I've already said where we are. It's a whole passel of things that are important. And then, sorry, after yesterday morning, I just have one pun. I'm saying, I bow down to her in the pun category. But just really important to remember, there's very different physical settings and perspectives among the states, different tribes and nations, and very different legal tools, really significant ones, and really just the bottom line is that politics is hard here. Players can't give water away. They can lose it, but they can't give it away. Hence, it's the really important role of the federal government in being the 800-pound gorilla here, albeit with a different set of tools that aren't quite as simple as they are in some of the environmental statutes that many of you have dealt with, like the Clean Water Act or the Clean Air Act or some of the other acts. And with that, I'll turn it to the solicitor.
All right. Great. Thanks. Thank you so much, Felicia. And thank you all for coming here. It's really great to speak in front of you. And, you know, I think of my, when I first started out as a lawyer, I was in front of Judge Holland up in Anchorage a lot. And I was, one day I had a preliminary injunction hearing, and he issued the injunction right from the bench. And I was 27 years old and overjoyed. And Judge Holland looked at me and said, "Is there something else we should do?" And I thought, "I don't know, you know, call my clients." And he said, and I said, "Summary judgment?" He said, "You're on my wavelength now." And, you know, I hope that I can be on the same wavelength and give you a good overview of the situation from the interior perspective here. And Felicia mentioned the federal government as an 800-pound gorilla. It's hard for me to think of Secretary Holland as a gorilla, but she does have a lot of power that resides in the Office of the Secretary of the Interior, and I've got a team of 450 lawyers who advise her on all matters, hundreds of cases in the Ninth Circuit at any given moment, and so we watch very carefully what we do. And so can I have the first slide, please? These are kind of busy slides, but they're in your packet, so you can have the information for reference later. But so we've got the Colorado River supplying water to the seven states, the upper and lower basins, and 30 Indian tribes with claim to the to water from the river and its tributaries. In the early 1920s, efforts came about to negotiate a compact among the states. Congress provided permission for the seven states to try to negotiate a way to divide the waters in the basin. And that effort met with some success, but not complete success. There was an agreement to divide the basin in half, upper and lower basin, with the upper basin having an obligation to deliver 7.5 million acre feet at Lee's Ferry for the lower basin states, Arizona, Nevada, and California. How those three states would divide that water was a bone of contention that really couldn't be resolved by a negotiation. They came close. Of course, California getting the lion's share of the water because of its size and population. At this time, under the shape of the law, it was apparent to some, although not clear, that the rule of prior appropriation, first in time and is first in right, might govern the law of might be the law of the Colorado River. And if that were the case, rapid development and population growth in California would result in California having the lion's share of the water under the prior appropriation doctrine, which the Supreme Court had ruled could be given interstate effect. And so other states did not want that to happen. Negotiations took place, and this is all in the backdrop, remember, of the Colorado River really running wild. So it's a river like it was supposed to be. It was untamed, undammed, and a gorgeous wonder of the world. But is with the course of westward expansion, the desire to tame the West, Congress passed the Boulder Canyon Project Act in 1928 that authorized the construction of Hoover Dam. There was no NEPA, there was no ESA, there was no National Historic Preservation Act. There were no constraints on the project, and there's amazing footage of the building of that dam on various PBS specials. So the dam was built to constrain the river and provide a mechanism for delivery of water to the lower basin states. The statute also set up the Secretary of the Interior to what we call the water master of the river. And so no water could be delivered from this 29 million acre foot reservoir without a contract from the Secretary of the Interior. And so the Secretary has got a huge role in providing the mechanism, the legal mechanism, for states and individual irrigation districts to obtain water. So we make contracts with irrigation district. And the Boulder Project Act also authorized another compact negotiation within the three states, which ended up in front of the Supreme Court nearly 40 years later in 1963 in Arizona v. California, in which the court determined that the 1928 Act worked a division of the lower basin's 7.5 million acre feet into 4.4 million for California, 2.8 million for Arizona, and 300,000 acre feet for Nevada. If there was a surplus of water in the lower basin, then California and Arizona would share that 50-50. When these calculations were made, unbeknownst to us, it was one of the wettest periods in history, and now we're in the drier period. And so when we came into Interior in 2021, we've got this big reservoir down there, two of them, they're nearly empty. I mean, this is the granddaddy of the Colorado River cases that affirms this apportionment among the lower basin states. Also has a short section at the end that clarifies that Indian tribes along the Colorado River have reserved water rights under the Winters Doctrine, which many of you are familiar with. And also carefully notes that the Secretary of the Interior has the task of managing the river through these contracts authorized by Section 5 of the statute, and that the Secretary has the authority to propose criteria for the management of these waters in times of emergency and shortage. I read the dissenting opinion this morning just to see what the beef was about back then, to remind myself, and it was about this secretarial authority to apportion. The dissent would have said, well, it should be done pursuant to an equitable apportionment that the special master had laid out. And the majority said, no, the secretary needs to have broad authority to do what is in the public interest to protect health, safety, and welfare of the population. And that's what we're relying on now as we face these shortages. If the states can't agree to a method of dividing the water when there's shortages below these 7.5 million acre feet, our belief is that the secretary's got the authority to come in and can divide those waters among the states and the contractors pursuant to her authority to protect the public interest, health, safety, and welfare. And I think there's sharp disagreement about that, but we think that we have the authority to do that, and if the states don't agree, they've got a choice of, they could litigate it, and probably in Arizona v. California in the Supreme Court, and I think there's not much appetite for reopening the decree in the U.S. Supreme Court, the preferred route is for the state to reach agreement and to come up with a way to share the shortages, that is what has happened now with the modern drought framework. So in 2005, there was a proposal to, as we started to have dry years, to figure out a way to divide up the waters. Again, the secretary threatened to act. The states reached a compromise as to how they would divide waters in times of shortage. That agreement expires in 2026, and that's what we're going to work on next, is to come up with a plan. We've got a notice of intent under NEPA out to start that planning process. The severe drought that we've had in the last 5 or 6 years really prompted the crisis that we had this year, where, again, we decided to do a supplemental EIS, propose a 10% cut across the board on all water users in the basin, in the lower basin, in order to deal with the fact that the reservoirs were getting dangerously low to where they could not operate to deliver water or generate power anymore. And so that plan made it out the door. Fortunately for us, Congress also passed the Inflation Reduction Act and the bipartisan infrastructure law. So we were in a position of not just telling the states to conserve, but saying, we will pay you to conserve, which is a lot easier way to get something done, to pay somebody to do it. It's like telling my daughter, mow the lawn and I'll give you $20. It gets done the second way much better. And same here, the states came together. They have put forward a proposed alternative for the NEPA analysis that has allowed us to put the two alternatives that we had with the 10% cut that we had forecasted or planned on doing aside and analyze their alternative that has a different sharing formula that they've developed, and we will release a draft supplemental with that analysis in the coming months to get us through this 2 year period. So it's the money from those two federal laws and the incredible snowpack that we've had this past year that has allowed the reservoirs to come up and delivered us from this crisis. But it's going to come up again, you know, with climate change. And so the post 2026 operational regime is what's on the table now, and that's where we're starting to shift our focus to develop that process and try to deliver a plan for dealing with those shortages and management in the future through a new plan that will finish in this first term of this administration is the goal. So we'll see if we can get there. And again, you know, we would welcome consensus from the states in what to do going forward. But, you know, typically that doesn't happen until the secretary threatens to do something. So states call out for leadership. Secretary needs to be a leader, needs to be, do something, you need to be a leader. Okay, we'll do something. And not that, don't do that. And then they come together and on we go. So it's a fast-paced, fascinating project, just like so many things I get to work on, and I'm really honored to speak to you and to be part of this panel and work on such a great topic of huge controversy and huge importance. So thank you very much.
I'm Ann Castle. I think Felicia did a great job of talking about the complexity of this system. But the basic reason we're here and talking about this today, and the reason reporters all over the country are writing about the Colorado River system, is because we have an imbalance between supply and demand. That is the basic problem. So I'm going to talk a little bit about how we got there. And starting with the allocations that were done in 1922 with the Colorado River Compact, in our 1944 treaty with Mexico. Basically, the compact said equal division between the upper basin and the lower basin. The upper basin is the four states of Colorado, New Mexico, Utah, and Wyoming, Lower Basin, Arizona, California, and Nevada. Equal division, not quite. The Lower Basin gets an extra 1 million acre feet. 7.5 million acre feet is the basic equal allocation between the Upper Basin and the Lower Basin. And the currency that we use in the Colorado River system is millions of acre feet. It's a lot of water. Then we have the treaty with Mexico in 1944, guaranteed 1.5 million acre feet per year to Mexico, delivered at the border. There's some caveats in there in times of surplus, in times of shortage, but basically 1.5 million acre feet a year. So you add all that up, you add in evaporation and losses, and there are lots of losses and lots of evaporation in this system, you come up with 19 million acre feet. Spoiler alert, we have never had that much water in the system. So uses, that was legal entitlement, 19 million acre feet. Uses, this is a very high-level summary of the uses in the system. And I'll just acknowledge that these numbers are estimates. There are people who would argue with every single one of these numbers because there's different ways to estimate them, and there's ranges, and it varies from year to year. But this is a pretty good overview. So outflows, Upper Basin use, about 3.5 to 4 million acre feet. Upper Basin evaporation adds another 0.4. Lower Basin main stem use, 7 to 7.5 million acre feet. Lower Basin tributaries, these are like the Gila and the Virgin, the Salt River. There's another 1 to 2 million acre feet. That's a really hard one to get a handle on. It's not well measured. Evaporation and losses in the Lower Basin and to Mexico. So if you add all those up, you get 14.9 to 16.9. Let's call it 15 to 17 million acre feet just because that's easy to remember. Then we have what's actually happening. This is a bar chart of natural flow in the system, starting with our records back in the early 1900s. And natural flow at Lee Ferry. Lee Ferry is the division point between the Upper Basin and the Lower Basin. And natural flow is a reconstructed number. So what they do to get to natural flow is they look at the gauges and see how much stream flow is passing this point, and then you add back in all the diversions upstream. So you're trying to get to a number of the flow that would have been there but for any human intervention. So the first thing you can see on this slide is that this is a really volatile system. There's a huge differential year to year, but you can see some trends. So this is the average flow in the system in the 20th century, a little over 15 million acre feet. If we go to the 21st century, since the year 2000, we're down 2 million acre feet. We're down to 13.2. And then if you look at the 5 years prior to this one, it's only 10.7. This is the impact of climate change, of warming temperatures that decrease the runoff, decrease the amount of flow in the streams. So this is this latest average is going to go up this year because we had a really good winter in the high country. But this tells us that we can have five-year periods like we did from 2018 to 2022 that are really, really low. So if you think about these numbers and compare them to the previous slide where we're looking at 15 to 17 million acre feet of annual use, you can see we've got a problem. There's a big gap between supply and demand. We've been able to do that because we have a lot of reservoir storage in the Colorado River Basin. The two largest reservoirs in the country, Lake Mead and Lake Powell, are in this basin. And this is a chart that shows what's been happening to the reservoirs as we've used them to offset that gap between supply and demand. The top blue line is overall storage in the Colorado River system. The orangish line is just Lake Powell and Lake Mead. You can see that we had full reservoirs in the early 1980s. They went down, they came back up. At the beginning of this century, they were almost full. And then we had very significant drought in the early 2000s. You can see those lines going pretty much straight down. We kind of bump along for a while. We had a good year in 2011. We go up again, we come down, and we've just like shot down like a roller coaster over the last 5 years. And again, that will go up again because of this year, but it won't come up to where it was. And the problem is that we're taking more out than is than Mother Nature is supplying us with. So Bob talked about the federal government role, and I want to highlight the differences in the federal government role between the upper basin and the lower basin. So just to reiterate, the Secretary of the Interior is the water master in the lower basin. You have to have a contract with her if you want to take water out of Lake Mead. She has some emergency authority. Bob alluded to that. It's not well-defined what that emergency authority is, but we know that there's something there, that when things are getting really bad, she can do more than is usually done on a regular basis. The Bureau of Reclamation is an interesting agency in that, unlike a lot of federal agencies like EPA or Forest Service, Reclamation doesn't have general authority. Its authority is based in each of its projects. And so Reclamation and the Commissioner of Reclamation, they have authority to protect and preserve the integrity of those projects, to operate the projects, but they don't have general authority over water use in the western United States. Sometimes Reclamation gets authority that's provided by agreement. What I've cited to you here is called the Drought Response Operations Agreement, which gives them the ability to manipulate the contents of the reservoirs in the upper basin, but that's the exception rather than the rule. Also, environmental compliance is a big component of how Interior acts and how Reclamation acts within the Colorado River system. You all know major federal actions require investigation of environmental impacts. So right now, Interior is in the process of a supplemental environmental impact statement that is looking at emergency actions to deal with these very low reservoir conditions. These actions will take effect for the next 3 or so years. All of our operating rules in the Colorado River expire in 2026. And so we're ginning up the discussion of a new set of operating rules. Interior has initiated that process. It's a big environmental compliance process. So that's going to keep people occupied for a while. So in the upper basin, different from the lower basin, the Secretary is not the water master. Water rights in the upper basin are administered by each of the state engineers, who are usually the heads of the Department of Water Resources. They tell people when they can divert water, how much they can divert, they monitor the system. You don't need a contract with the Secretary to use water in the upper basin. And the upper basin states are very wary of federal intervention. And the primary federal hook, the primary federal authority in the upper basin is around operation of the federal projects. And there are a lot of federal water projects in the upper basin states. But we know because of recent history that federal manipulation of the water projects in the upper basin will be fiercely resisted. And there has been a lot of concern around that, particularly recently, like in the last year. The federal government does not have the authority in the upper basin to, or at least not clear authority, to require reductions of use or shepherding of saved water. Shepherding means that if somebody's using less water than they're entitled to and saving it intentionally in order to get it down to the reservoirs to protect against those reservoirs reaching critical levels, you want to protect that water in the system as it goes down, protect it from other diversions. That's called shepherding. The federal government doesn't have authority to shepherd water. The state engineers do. And there's disputed authority about retaining water in these federal reservoirs to use for future compliance. There's also significant plumbing differences between the upper basin and the lower basin, in that most lower basin uses are downstream from Lake Mead. Lake Mead has a lot of water in it. It's a guaranteed supply in a lot of ways. Most of the reservoirs in the upper basin are downstream from the major uses, which means that upper basin water users are much more subject to natural hydrological variation. They don't have this big reservoir upstream that can provide them with a guaranteed supply. So much less possibility for using more water than nature provides. Another difference is evaporation. evaporation in the upper basin is absorbed by water users before the water reaches Lake Powell and is released from Lake Powell to supply the lower basin, to supply Lake Mead. So all the evaporation that happens takes place, but the amount of water that goes from Lake Powell to Lake Mead stays the same. In the lower basin, deliveries to lower basin users don't reflect the amount of evaporation that occurs off the surface of Lake Mead and the other major reservoirs. So that's about 1.5 million acre feet a year. That's a significant issue. I will close by just mentioning one other issue that is significant in the Colorado River Basin that's sort of off the topic of this allocation and usage. And that is tribal access to clean drinking water. It's a sad fact that 500,000 people in Native communities across the country don't have access to reliable water supplies, clean drinking water, or basic sanitation. And that is tragic in 2023. This issue exists in the Colorado River Basin. It's been estimated that 30 to 40% of households in the Navajo Nation don't have running water in their homes. This is a service that most Americans take for granted, and it is unfinished business of our republic that it is not the case universally across the Colorado River Basin and across the country. Legislation recently enacted is very helpful. It is not enough. And this needs to be part of the overall discussion about operations in the basin. Thank you.
Well, good morning, everybody. I'm honored to be here today in front of such a distinguished audience and with such distinguished panelists, and not a lawyer. Makes me a little bit nervous. But I really love the title of this session, because what I'm going to do is almost literally get beneath the surface and bring in a little bit about groundwater into this discussion, because we've been talking about the Colorado River water and surface water. And if you thought things were complex so far, they get even more complex when you literally look beneath the surface and what's going on there. And that photo in the background was taken in December, leaving Colorado River water users from a plane, and you can see Hoover Dam in the bottom there, and that's Lake Powell. And I don't have the comparison photo, but it would have looked very different 20 years ago. So I'm going to start my story with Governor Bruce Babbitt, former Interior Secretary, distinguished governor of Arizona. And this screenshot is from a documentary, and I have the link in my slide, so when they're distributed, people could get this. This is a less than 30-minute documentary, Groundwater to Enact a Law for the Common Good. And this is where Governor Babbitt fessed up. He probably told others along the way that he kind of set up the whole thing where the Interior Secretary said, if you want to get funding for that Central Arizona project that's going to bring surface water into your state, you better do something about groundwater, because the federal government doesn't want to build a very expensive project to see you dealing with groundwater in an unregulated way. So in 1980, the legislature passed the Groundwater Management Act with emergency provisions, and I encourage people to watch that documentary. It's really good. But the Arizona law, still to this day, by and large, does not recognize the connection between surface water and groundwater. And we know, I show you here a graphic of the hydrologic cycle, that they are connected. But laws end up being so important to what you see on the ground in terms of policy and management. This is a slide I use in the first meeting of the graduate course I teach every spring, water policy in Arizona and semi-arid regions. And I haven't underlined the words just for you here today. These are the words I underline every time I show this, that you can look at that long list of factors that influence what you see, of course, water availability, economics, costs, all that sort of stuff, politics. But the legal framework is so incredibly important. And then who's making the decisions? You know, what level of government is making the decisions? And in many cases, we have overlapping levels of government involved. And so when these things do get to the courts, it may be in the state courts, it may be in the federal courts, and maybe in both. And the context is really important. And so I'm going to drill down a little bit here into some just facts and figures, and I have some maps because pictures can say 1,000 words. To your right, I have a map from the Bureau of Reclamation of the Colorado River Basin. Just one thing I want to point out about that, we've already talked about 7 states, upper basin, lower basin, but the dark outline is of the hydrologic boundaries. But if you look at those red hatched areas, like in Southern California, Denver, Salt Lake City, water is taken out of the hydrologic boundaries of the basin and serve people in California, as Bob Anderson indicated. They're not actually within the hydrologic boundaries of the basin. In Arizona, if you look at the Arizona water picture and the distribution of sources, Colorado River water is extremely important. It's about more than a third. But groundwater, on average, is even more important. Over 40%, and those percentages are changing over time. We're experiencing cutbacks of surface water, we're experiencing switching or increasing use of groundwater. Then if you look at the uses, the big use is agriculture, and the number 70 to 80% applies to the basin overall. It applies globally if you look at global figures. We do have to worry about producing food for the people of the world, and parts of the West are very good for growing. People ask the question all the time, why are you growing in the hot weather? It's actually good to grow certain things in the hot weather, and they can grow all year round. When you then get into the mosaic of what is happening at the state, you have to remember that groundwater is largely regulated, if regulated, at the state level, not the federal level. And even river systems, if they're wholly within state boundaries, do not have state federal involvement in their regulation. So we have lots of mosaics, and I'm going to show you a few of here. That map on your right? Do I have that right? It's on your right with the active management areas on there. Or is it your left? It's a little confusing up here. It's on the left. I'm not dyslexic, but I'm having a little trouble up here. It shows the shaded areas where there are active management areas. All that unshaded area, that tan in the background, no regulation of groundwater at all. It's kind of like Wild West free-for-all. We even have interesting things going on in the law right now. We're in the lower right, southeastern portion of Arizona. Voters took upon themselves to create an active management area because they're frustrated that the legislature wasn't doing anything. But now there's a petition to recall that election. And you know what the lawyers say? It's not clear that the law allows for that. So who knows whether it's going to go to the ballot or not. It's just always so interesting. On the right is the land ownership map. And in Arizona, the white color is the privately owned land. It's less than 20% of the land area in the state of Arizona is privately owned. You've got the green areas of tribal lands. You've got all that orangey color of federal lands. And you've got blue state lands. And so that affects water rights of and sometimes they're quantified, sometimes they're not. Sometimes they're surface water, sometimes they're groundwater and surface water. Again, just a complicated situation. And then to your left about the water use, we have parts of the state like Yuma, which grows all the vegetables in the winter, that's almost totally reliant on surface water. And then if you look at other areas that are the teal color, they're almost totally reliant on groundwater. So you can't paint the picture with a single color, with a single brushstroke. There's so much nuance to it. And then on the right, I circle some agricultural zones within Arizona because, again, they're different. The Yuma area has high priority surface water rights. The Colorado River Indian tribes have the highest priority rights. They don't have the labor situation that they do in Yuma because of the proximity to the border and the ability to harvest some of the vegetables and the like. Central Arizona has been hard hit by the shortage, and then you have areas dependent on groundwater. So Arizona, it was mentioned earlier by Felicia, I think, or somebody, that in order to get the funding for the Central Arizona Project, in order to get it approved, Arizona had to agree on lower priority of water delivered through the Central Arizona Project. And that's a constructed canal, 336 miles long, pushes water uphill. And within the Colorado, within the Central Arizona Project, we have priorities there. And the lowest priority is really to the agricultural users. So we've experienced Tier 1 and Tier 2A cutbacks in 2022 and 2023. They've had major impacts on agriculture and some others, but the municipal and industrial and Indian have the higher priority. Here, lower on the block is better than higher on the block. But we were really worried. Again, you've heard it already. This last winter kind of gave us a reprieve. But we can't expect it to occur year after year because actually the hydrology has shown after a good winter, we tend to have some pretty bad winters of precipitation. So nobody's really letting up, but we got a reprieve for a couple years. But these have been real impacts on users. What happens in Central Arizona when there's less surface water delivered for agriculture? Well, that groundwater law, 1980 Groundwater Act, actually it put in conservation requirements, it put in quantification of rights, but those rights by agriculture are held in perpetuity. So if there's groundwater there to be pumped, they can go back on the pump. Now, it's not cheap. There are water quality issues, but that's what's happening. There's more pumping going on by agriculture. There's land fallowing that has economic implications. And here's the looking beneath the surface, literally. This upper left diagram is a cross-section from a Department of Water Resources model that shows that blue is getting further and further down. And our State Department of Water Resources is telling groundwater users, you can't depend on these these groundwater supplies to prove up the 100 years that the Groundwater Management Act requires. And so first it was in this farming area, but then if you look at the Washington Post screenshot I have up there, it says Phoenix area can't meet groundwater demands over the next century, threatening growth. That was like June 1st of this year. It's not quite the Phoenix area. There's lots of nuance, don't have time to get into that. But this is in the Washington Post. Folks, From some of these newspapers and outlets have people living in Arizona because they're following the water stuff so carefully. And then there's the Saudi Arabians. How many of you have heard about the Saudi pumping going on in Arizona? Come on, raise your hand. You're not reading the newspapers if you're not raising your hand, because it's getting a lot of national attention. Is what's going on here, the Saudis pumping groundwater? Well, the Saudis and others are pumping groundwater because they can, and because we have free markets, global markets. And then the last one is about proposals now being submitted to look at these groundwater rules. And as Felicia mentioned, there's a show in the next slide, a new water policy council dealing with groundwater yet again. But I wanted to mention, yesterday I thought it was so interesting, past its prologue, I think it was you, Judge Simon, who talked about past its prologue. Well, what we're finding in our water world is that you can't look at the past like you did to model what's going to happen in the future. And there was a very well-read, very well-known science article about stationarity is dead. You can't assume the past is prologue on hydrology. And then last December, Deputy Reclamation Commissioner Dave Palumbo said stationarity is dead from a policy viewpoint, not only hydrologic viewpoint. It means we have to reinvent. We have to come up with different and better policies. So this is what, you know, we're trying to do now. As I mentioned with Governor Babbitt, there was a threat, there was a crisis that led to action, and we keep wondering, is it gonna take a crisis? It seems to take a crisis. You know, we had the crisis of the 2 to 4 million acre foot cut that Commissioner Tootin of Reclamation said was needed last June, but then we had a good winter. So we're going to try again and see what we can come up with. What can the governor do with executive powers? What can the legislature possibly do? We've had a stalemate there. Despite all this stuff that may sound like bad news, there's a lot of solutions in front of us. And this is just a list. Some of them are short run, medium, long term, expensive. You can't just flip on a switch and tell farmers use drip instead of flood irrigation. It takes some time, they're working on it. And I do want to emphasize, it's already been said, this issue about shared borders. I'm part of a transboundary aquifer assessment program. It's sometimes a bit less sexy than dealing with the surface water stuff, but we share groundwater as well as surface water across borders, and the whole view of the basin looks different if you're a tribal nation like the Navajo Nation that spans the upper basin, lower basin, where the law says they're totally separate. You can't move water between the two uses within the Navajo Nation. So it's really a complex situation. So having said all this, am I optimistic? Am I pessimistic? I ask this of speakers now, because a couple years ago, John at Crua, Colorado River Water Users, when I moderated a panel on some of these water supply situation, I used the word optimism, and somebody from my own university there said to me, Sharon, this is not right. You can't talk about optimism. It's really a bad, serious situation. But you know, if you don't have some optimism, it's really hard to go to work every day and work on these things, you know? And so is the glass half full or half empty? And then I found this picture of a glass. I put a little link on it because it comes from some commercial site. We're talking about a third full or a quarter full. I think the lake's up to, what, 32% right now, Lake Mead, something like that. I looked at that. But I'm optimistic that we'll get to where we have to be, because failure's not an option, and we have to adapt. And I have my email address. I welcome anybody to contact me anytime. This was a quick and dirty view of things, but I really appreciate the opportunity.
Thank you. So the benefit of going last is you get to make minor corrections. The only one I would note is it was said that the decree in Arizona v. California split surplus waters 50% to Arizona and 50% to California. That's actually 50% to California, 46% to Arizona, and 4% to Nevada. So if that issue ever comes before the Ninth Circuit, Nevada has not waived its claims to those surplus waters.
Small but mighty.
Small but mighty. Speaking of small, just to give you a little bit of context of why the Colorado is so important to the state of Nevada, we have a robust legal entitlement of 1.8% to the river. If you add up the seven states, the country of Mexico, all the evaporation losses that Ann and others talked about, we have 1.8% of the river, which is 90% of the water supply for 76% of the state's population. So very high stakes for Nevada. And we don't get a lot from other places. You know, Sharon showed, you know, Arizona has water from the Salt River Project. They have some pretty robust aquifers. Southern Nevada is the driest urban area in the country. We get right about 4 inches of rain every year. So we have to do more with less. And that starts with indoor recycling. Everything that hits a drain in Southern Nevada is recycled. So I use the example, you could leave every hotel room on the Las Vegas Strip, the showers running, the faucets on 365 days a year, 24 hours a day, and we wouldn't deplete one drop of water from the Colorado River. We recycle everything that hits a drain. So all of our conservation measures are geared towards reducing our outdoor water footprint. Even with 1.8% of the river, we have a couple of big strategic advantages. Our number one strategic advantage is we're upstream of Hoover Dam. That has allowed us to construct $1.5 billion in new infrastructure in the form of a low lake level pumping station, that's the little green house there, and a third intake, which is a 3-mile tunnel, 20 feet in diameter, drilled underneath Lake Mead with the intake riser actually located in the Colorado River channel where the river was before the construction of Hoover Dam. So you can't get any lower than that. And the reason that's critical is we can now pump water from elevation 875 above sea level. At elevation 895, so 20 feet above our intake, that's where it is physically impossible for the Bureau of Reclamation to release water through Hoover Dam. If you get to Deadpool, which Felicia mentioned, it is impossible. You know, laws of man aside, the laws of physics take over at that point, and you cannot deliver water to about 25 million Americans in Phoenix and coastal California. So being upstream of the dam is a big deal for us. Growth. People, you know, that guy at the cocktail party, why don't you just stop growth? Is going to be one of the things he talks about. He's also going to bring up, you know, bringing water from the Mississippi River and desalination. So we can talk about those things if you'd like. Growth and increased water usage is not a one-to-one correlation. Just in the last 3 years, in Southern Nevada, we've added 47,000 new connections. So that could be one connection is a hotel casino. One connection is a single family resident. That's about double what we were seeing 17, 18, 19. The population influx into Southern Nevada, primarily from California during and post pandemic, has really been incredible. But in that same 3-year period when we added those 47,000 new connections, we reduced our net water usage by 12%. And over the last two decades, the numbers are even more stark. We, since 2002, we've added over 800,000 new residents to Southern Nevada. We've reduced our per capita water usage by over 50%, and our net depletions off of the Colorado River are down almost a third. So with all of the truly serious issues that the other panelists have talked about today, we do have a structural deficit. We have a warmer, drier future ahead of us. We have net uses of between 15 and 17 million acre feet, and the best climate scientists in the world are telling us we'll be lucky to have 11 million acre feet by mid-century. So every water user in every sector is going to have to use less water. But the good news that I hope I'm imparting to you is that the example of Las Vegas, of all places, right, shockingly, sustainability is possible. Growth with a zero to negative water footprint is possible, but it's going to take substantial investment and it's going to take political will. So speaking of which, how did we reduce our water footprint that much? Primarily by going after grass. And it's been said in a number of forums, the Colorado River has a water problem. It's true. But more than anything, the Colorado River has a grass problem. The number one usage in municipal sector from Denver, Albuquerque, Salt Lake City, Phoenix, LA, Vegas is Bermuda, fescue, Kentucky blue. And the number one use in agriculture is alfalfa, Sudan grass. Agriculture uses 80% of the water on the Colorado River, and 80% of that 80% is forage crops. So the vast majority of Colorado River water is going to grass. And in Las Vegas, we've basically gone to war with grass. we pay people $3 a square foot to remove their grass. To date, you can see on the graphic, we've removed enough grass in Las Vegas to lay an 18-inch wide piece of sod all the way around the earth at the equator. So sustainable growth. New development, as I said, really has to have a zero to negative water footprint. So I'll just talk a little bit about other things we've done. In 2021, Governor Sisolak signed Assembly Bill 356, which mandated the removal of all non-functional turf by January 1, 2027. So what's non-functional turf? If the only guy who walks on it is the guy mowing it, it's non-functional. If you won't allow your kid or grandkid to play frisbee on it because of traffic, it's non-functional. So all of that grass has to come out, and we estimate that'll save us about 20,000 acre feet of water. Evaporative cooling. We've now instituted a ban on using evaporative cooling in new buildings. We're the first municipal area in the country to do that. It's not always obvious where our water is going, but your cell phone is a water hog. Data centers, two major data centers, use as much water for evaporative cooling as a golf course does. So we have the technologies. We have a new $400 million data center going into North Las Vegas that uses zero water because mechanical cooling technologies exist. No new grass. The only places you can plant grass in Southern Nevada now are schools, parks, and cemeteries. You buy a new home, a new build, no more. No new golf courses. And the existing golf courses have all been put on budgets. We've limited new swimming pools to no more than 600 square feet. And I can tell you with some degree of confidence that the luxury pool building industry in Southern Nevada, of all the people we've upset, they're the most likely to murder me in my sleep. and then water pricing, we've put in an excess use charge to really send that economic signal to our customers that they need to use less. So overall, you add all that stuff up, our goal is to get to 86 gallons per capita per day by 2035. We reduced from 107 to 101 just between 2021 and 2022, and we're tracking to be below 100 this year. So I come to you, I think, with a message of optimism. As Sharon said, it's going to be incredibly difficult to adapt this river to the warmer, drier future that we all know is confronting us. But the good news is, it's entirely possible. Thank you.
Thank you, and I'm not gonna go through this slide, but just to keep that story arc, there is a lot we can do in urban and agricultural, and we do need to develop the relationships among all the parties to figure out how to get there together as best we can. And then, as John reiterated, that guy at the cocktail party, it's definitely not icebergs. All of us being towed, all of us have been inundated by brilliant suggestions that are actually very well intended, but each one has a cost, a reality, a physical solution. I will tell you that no one on the Mississippi or the Great Lakes is offering us any water, nor is anyone in the Northwest offering California any water, et cetera. But you will hear these, and someday off into the future, when we do the lowest hanging fruit of conservation, recycling, stormwater capture, et cetera, with efficiency first and foremost being the cheapest and smartest way to go, but it requires change. Some of the technological breakthroughs and things will be useful, and some of them are already useful today in given circumstances. So thank you, panel. You did a really pretty good job of staying on time. And I'm going to leave this slide up, and I'm going to move over here for the questions to give myself the illusion of more authority at some point. I don't know. Hopefully this is on. And thank you for already starting the questions. I'm going to start off with one as more of you fill out those cards and other people get them to me. But what are the big moving pieces and options for 2026? I mean, if you look at the numbers that Anne put out there, there are millions of acre feet of expectation that have to be dialed back. We've talked specifically about a lot of the urban uses, which happens because you can't fallow a city because you have more resources and the like, but an awful lot of the water comes from the agricultural communities that are actually growing food and fiber for us and have a thriving economy, and in many cases, not all, have the most senior water rights. So can you each briefly touch on both agriculture and the tribal issues of how we bring the tribes into the conversation, either one or both? And I'm going to start with John, because he focused mostly on the future and less on the negotiations or where we need to go, and he's one of the people in the room.
Sure, and just to clarify, you know, why the date 2026? So the 2007 guidelines, minute 319, minute 323 with Mexico, the drought contingency plan that passed Congress in 2019, all of those interim agreements expire December 31st, 2026. So if we get to January 1, 2027 without a new negotiated set of agreements amongst the seven states, and probably the seven states and Mexico, we revert to the post-2007 operating regime, which when we last left it in about 2005 had us had our toes on the line of original jurisdiction litigation in front of the U.S. Supreme Court. So it's not a place we particularly want to go back to. The big tension in my mind going into those negotiations is the difference between equitable apportionment and prior appropriation. And those seeds are in the compact. The first line of the 22 compact is the purpose of this compact is to equitably apportion the Colorado River. And most of the motivation behind that, as Bob alluded to, is the fact that the upper basin states in particular, coming out of the Supreme Court case in Colorado v. Wyoming, wanted to avoid the application of prior appropriation across state lines. But then later in the compact, it says nothing herein shall affect prior perfected rights. So it embeds, you know, senior rights, protecting senior rights within the same four-page document. Fast forward to February, the federal government puts out a supplemental environmental impact statement with alternative one, you know, being apply prior appropriation across state lines. So that is going to be the tension, because if you strictly enforce prior appropriation, you can literally evacuate Denver, Albuquerque, Salt Lake City, Vegas, Phoenix, and Los Angeles and not balance the books between that 15 to 17 million acre feet in usage and the 11 million acre feet we're likely to see. So strict application of prior appropriation really isn't an option in the real world, regardless of what, you know, the four corners of black letter law, you know, say to you. So we're gonna have to figure out a way for as equitably as possible amongst agriculture, urban, tribal, and environmental uses to negotiate a flexible but durable set of agreements that get us out more towards mid-century.
Thanks, John. And I wanted John to do a longer piece because he focused so much on the urban efficiency work. So if the rest of you can give some quick answers, then we'll move to the questions. We'll come back to some of my other questions if we run out of the audience questions.
I'll just quickly address the Indian water rights aspect that you asked about. And you know, we have been aggressively negotiating Indian water rights settlements that passed through Congress for over 30 years. And so there have been about 35 of them. And so we continue to do that throughout the West, in particular in New Mexico and Arizona and Montana most recently. We had this U.S. Supreme Court case, Arizona versus Navajo Nation, where the nation sued us to try to force the United States to simply ascertain the scope of their water rights. It's not something that we're not doing. We're involved in negotiations and litigation on behalf of the nation. But we had a very nice Ninth Circuit. I was recused from this case. We had a very nice Ninth Circuit decision that ordered us to assess the water rights of the nation to provide information about how they might be served by various water sources, including the Colorado River. And the Solicitor General filed a cert petition, and the Supreme Court reversed what I thought was an excellent Ninth Circuit decision. They even cited one of my articles, which I was very thankful for. But you know, we're undeterred by that. That's a sort of arcane area of administrative law in Indian trust assets. I'm disappointed in the Supreme Court's 5-4 decision, but the Interior Department is still working regularly to investigate it and assert tribal reserved water rights so they can have the resources that Ann correctly noted should be provided in a just world.
And I'll just add that we've got this huge gap between supply and demand, and it is big enough so that no one basin, no one state, no one sector of the economy can do enough to offset it. It has to be across the basin wide, where all sectors, all states are owning a piece of the problem. We've heard that agriculture is 75% to 80% of overall use in the Colorado River Basin. You can't, as John said, balance the books just on municipal usage, even with the great example that Southern Nevada provides, which, by the way, has not been adopted by other major municipalities. So there are gains to be made in municipal conservation, but that's not enough by itself. There are gains to be made in agricultural efficiency, but I don't think that's enough by itself. We're going to see less agricultural irrigated land in this basin. There's just no other way to get to the end of the equation. And we have to be really smart about that. We all like to eat food. And so we have to figure out how we're going to adjust to this different world of less water available and less ability to irrigate than we've had in the past. One other thing that I wanted to mention about the tribal water is, and it's been said, tribes control a huge segment of water in the Colorado River Basin, either already decreed or settled or claimed, claims to be resolved in the future. We have some great examples in Arizona and in California of tribes that have come to the table and become a part of the solution. One of the interesting and useful components of tribal water rights is for various historical reasons, they are frequently not entirely used or developed. And so that gives the tribes some flexibility to be part of the solution, to lease their water rights to municipalities and help address the gap between supply and demand. The Gila River Indian community in Arizona, the Colorado River Indian tribes in the two states have both done creative deals in the lower basin that help to balance the system.
So I'll just be very brief because pretty much the important points have been made, but I'm going to pick up on the issues of what is the potential for agriculture and also issues of consultation. There's much to be learned from each other and much to be learned from other countries like Israel and drip irrigation and so forth. As I said earlier, you can't just flip the switch. I didn't take the time, but in one of my slides, I showed the most recent issue of Irrigation Leader magazine, and it pictures the chairwoman of the Colorado River Indian Tribes, Amelia Flores, on the cover. They've done a lot with drip irrigation and trying to look at what are the water savings, what does it do to yield, because they need to have that experience. You can't just switch and then not get the crop produced. So there's a lot going on. There's a lot to be learned. Fallowing is really like the F word because it has bad implications for not only the farmers, but for the communities, so many of the rural communities. We're talking about spreading burden. That's not fun. And you try to alleviate or mitigate that burden. And I just can't help but say this, and that is, it's very easy, and the farmers will say, to demonize alfalfa. But much of that alfalfa is going to feed the cows that produce the dairy products that we all like to eat. And so if we start complaining about higher food prices and all that, which is could come from it, we just have to realize that this is kind of a vertically integrated, horizontally integrated economy that we have, and there are implications. So I just want to put that out there that the most important thing I think we can do is talk to each other. I observe in my state of Arizona, and I think somewhat more generally, there's a big separation of discussions of tribal versus non-tribal agriculture. And you've got big production agriculture going on by tribes. And like I said, Colorado River Indian Tribe's a great example. So we've got to keep talking to each other.
That was great. Thank you very much. Well, we have a lot of interesting questions from all different angles. Here's the first one, and again, you don't all have to answer each of them if somebody can take the lead, just so we can get through more of them. But this one was important for you all to answer. If the Colorado River ever gets too low to deliver power or water, what is the backup plan? Okay. Who wants to answer that one?
Well, you saw Nevada's backup plan. Yeah. So we can pump when you can't deliver water downstream. So we're basically guaranteed to always have water over our intakes.
Yeah, I mean, I think you imagine the dams coming out and then you're left with a free flowing river and you have to try to capture it. So that's not going to happen. But that's what this whole post 26 process is about. We're just in the scoping phase now to, you know, get ideas from the public. And this is where, you know, NEPA takes time and it's cumbersome. But you know, here now is a chance to explore different avenues for dealing with a situation like that. And you know, Nevada can get the last drop, but nobody wants us to get there. And so we need to figure out together, you know, how to deal with these shortages that are inevitable. Given the changing hydrograph.
And I think that a lot of the municipal suppliers that rely heavily on Colorado River water are looking at diversifying their portfolios so that they, if they can, so that they have other sources that are hopefully in play if the Colorado River is low. There are other instances like what John described in the intake that Southern Nevada built at the very lowest reaches of Lake Mead. In Lake Powell, there are communities like the city of Page, Arizona, and the Lachii chapter of the Navajo Nation that relied on a certain intake in Lake Powell that was in jeopardy And so the Bureau of Reclamation has been in the process of fixing that problem, tying them into a lower intake. So it looks different in different places. And there are a lot of plan Bs being worked on, but I'm not sure that we have an overall plan B if the system can't deliver water anymore.
Yes. Well, I just note the issue of diversification, and Felicia, you would know this by looking at the Los Angeles area water providers. They've done a tremendous job over the last several years of diversifying their portfolio away from Colorado River water deliveries and sometimes surface deliveries, a lot more reuse. And then groundwater, it's globally being relied on more to replace surface water, but some areas don't have the groundwater. But I'll tell you, the Yuma area farmers, who often they have a coalition, often their meetings are behind closed doors, but they opened up some of their meetings, and they were looking at what can they do in terms of investment in groundwater pumping capacity should that event happen. But we have to be in balance with nature at some point. So if it really is going to keep going down and down and down, a big plan B has to be developed.
But there's actually not one plan is the answer. It's sort of mutually assured destruction in some ways if we don't get ahead of the curve, but you also have people rapidly diversifying. And if you want, over a coffee, I can tell you everything the greater LA area is doing. It's probably the ground zero for climate adaptation in a water scarce region, with the two largest recycled water projects in the world being accelerated and worked on, because they know just how vulnerable they are. And it's the $300 million a year stormwater capture programs throughout the county, et cetera. So it's kind of every person for themselves, though, if it falls apart. So it's a challenge. For Bob, could you describe in a little bit better detail what tribal reserved rights to water are? Sorry, it's unfair to tell a professor to briefly answer that question a little more after what you said. So
the Winners case from 1908 involved the Fort Belknap Reservation and the tribe that needed to use water that was already being used by non-Indians who were upstream. And so the United States brought a lawsuit successfully to establish the principle that when the Indian reservation was established in 1868, the government also reserved sufficient water to fulfill the purposes of the reservation, which in this case were agriculture. And so the fact that the non-Indians who were upstream had a priority date of 1898 meant that they had to stop their diversions in order to allow the tribe to have sufficient water to fulfill the agricultural purpose of its reservation. And that doctrine is at the foundation of all of these Indian water rights settlements and litigation that we engage in.
Could I just say one thing?
Yeah, sure.
Maybe as a question to Bob. The reserve water rights pertain to federal lands, not only tribal lands. Is that correct?
That's correct. Not to BLM, public domain lands that we think of, but to national forests and national parks, wildlife refuges, and so on.
And to just tell a real quick story, if I may, about that, because the Forest Service put out a letter claiming some groundwater rights in Arizona at one point. I'm not sure if it was just a memo from the regional forester. And Senators Flake and McCain at the time wrote a letter in response to that and said, well, wait a minute, you can't talk about groundwater because surface water and groundwater are not connected in Arizona law. Something like that, if I remember correctly. Bob, you may remember it better. So again, that separation that comes in the law coming in again.
Well, here's a question that allows me to test your illuminate, not litigate, capabilities. Given California's relatively strong legal position under the case law, what incentive has California had to negotiate rather than litigate? Even as a Californian, I can answer that question, but I really want to hear what you each have to say. This is a test of our friendship.
Well, I would say, you know, one of the authorities are, in Section 5 of the Boulder Canyon Project Act, the Secretary is the water master of the lower basin. And, you know, we think that, you know, the court rejected the equitable apportionment notion based on a formula and was quite explicit in 1963 about the Secretary's authority to take into account various factors in distributing water when there's a shortage. It's three paragraphs long, it's ambiguous, and leaves us a lot of room for open field running if we want to take it. Additionally, we've got regulations that allow us to adjust the water contracts through a formal rulemaking process to change the terms of those contracts in order to take into account public safety, the public welfare, which could get at some of the excessive consumptive uses and require more conservation of the type that John was talking about. So there are tools out there. We don't want to use them. We would rather have a consensus solution, but you know, as the secretary's lawyer, you know, we're exploring all of those tools in case we need them in our toolbox. So we'll have at it if we have to.
And can I add to that as well?
Yeah.
California has certain legal rights, and there's controversy about exactly what those mean. But at the end of the day, you can stand on your legal rights and watch the system crash. And it didn't help you much. So California has incentive, just like everyone else, to be part of the solution and not allow the system to crash. And the dynamics and the politics are such that it is unlikely that the other states would agree to a solution that California was not a significant participant in. And we have some history on this sort of type of deal in the drought contingency plan that was reached in 2019. Even though California has superior rights over the Central Arizona Project by agreement and by congressional approval, California still agreed to absorb some shortages before the Central Arizona Project was completely wiped out. So there is a recognition, I think, among all the players, including California, that we're in this together.
Right. And I'd say there's litigation risk for everybody on everything. You can have
a last word,
and then I have to do the closing
okay,
question.
One minor point. Well, it's not a minor point, but I'll be brief. The guy at the cocktail party is from California. The first thing you tell him is California isn't homogenous. California isn't senior to everybody else. California is senior to CAP. That's it. Right, metropolitan, those 19 million people between Santa Barbara and San Diego, they're junior to Yuma. They have the exact same priority as Southern Nevada. So when people say California this or California that, you're not being nearly nuanced enough, because there are differences in priority amongst the major users in California, and they're not senior to everybody.
It is complicated. Well, I mean, thank you. Some of these questions, all of these questions are really good. I think we'll be around, so people are gonna be happy to answer them. I wish we could go through all of them. I want to thank the panel because they've given you an overview of the law and hydrology, et cetera, and a view of what's happening on the ground and some of our solutions. You're now ahead of 99.9% or more of the people in the universe on these issues. And I want you to do a very quick 20-second closing on, just so we leave it on a high note, but not a Hallmark card, what keeps you up at night and what gives you hope. Again, two sentences. Bob, why don't you start and we'll move down.
Well, we just look forward to working with the states and the water users to, you know, advance the public interest and take care of the people who live within the basin so they can get what they need.
Very politic, but not what gives you keeps you up at night or gives you hope, but I'll take it. Go ahead.
We're all in this together. Everybody has to feel a little pain and share a part of the burden. I'm also optimistic because I think really smart, savvy people are working on this and leading their states and their water districts, and they don't want to litigate. They all want to get to yes.
So I'd say, I said a little bit about optimism before, but I guess what concerns me is whether the people with the different viewpoints, the values, the political views can come together to address these issues, because we've not shown we can necessarily do that. And we need to, because that groundwater is fossil groundwater, it's running out. And litigation, I'd like to say, doesn't create water. And so we've got to come together, and I hope that we can.
Climate change and politicians keep me up at night. What gives me hope is the track record of the professional community on the Colorado River. For 20 plus years, we have innovated, we have adapted, and I believe we have the capacity to continue to do so. I have a copy of Minute 319 in my office that's been translated into Russian because it's being used as a model for transbasin boundary disputes in some of the former Soviet republics. So we have the tools, we have the capacity, we need the resources and the political will.
Excellent last word. Thanks, all.